marriage, love, sex, and meditation. Continuing and recapitulating what had been spoken. The energy is basically the same. Just as the water that runs in your house comes from this main supply. But there are different taps in different rooms. Some is known as kitchen tap, bathroom tap, and so on and so forth. Is there any difference in the water that is running from these sources? It is the outlet from where the water is obtained, is given the name. Basically, all the taps are same, but one tap is known as bathroom tap, kitchen tap, and so on and so forth. In the same way, energy is basically the same. It is in solid form. It manifests through different sources, and the source from where manifests is given that name. Basically, the energy is stored at the base center, which according to the chakras or the psychic centers which are found in the third body is known as Muladhara. In case of man, this center is masculine, and in case of a female, this center is feminine. The entire life energy is stored in this center in the form of a snake. That is why a snake is considered a symbol of energy. This in yoga is known as kundalini energy. From there it has to move and move through the various centers and continue its journey until it reaches the final destination. When it is stored at that point, it has its qualities. Put it this way, it has four wives: anger, frustration, jealousy, hatred. When the energy is in the solid form, the person's approach and attitude is totally different. Gets angry when this energy does not move. Frustration breeds in. But this energy from its source has to move. The next center. So it is like ice. Ice has to melt first, and when it melts, it begins to overflow, but in its present state, it remains there and melts in its own normal way, but it does not have enough for overflowing. So the journey begins. It begins to melt and overflow to the other center, which is water center. The location of the center is genitals. It moves to that center. It creates a balance between the two. And when it creates a balance, it begins to overflow other centers. When the energy moves from the base center to this center and a harmony, a balance is established, it is at this stage the physical aspect of the marriage, male-female relation, attains fulfillment. And that is the first criteria. This has to move. In the story that I had mentioned of Krishna, according to Bhagavat Mahapurana, the water of the river, the blue river that flowed on the bank of the outskirts of the city where Krishna grew up, Gokul, was Yamuna River. This snake, the king of snakes called Kaliya, came along with his four wives and settled in the cave in that river. Because of his poison, the water got polluted. What is this poison that comes out of this serpent or the kundalini or the sex energy? It is like a poison. Anger, frustration, hatred, jealousy, these are the qualities of the person where sex remains unfulfilled. Krishna arranges something and allows his ball to go into the river. He jumps into. The snake was sleeping. This energy is always in the form of rest or sleeping. It has to be awakened, and when it is awakened, then its journey has to begin. So Krishna enters into a fight with that energy, which normally happens that each one of us enters into a fight. Sometimes the energy dominates and you have an angry gesture, always angry for one thing or the other, always quarrelsome and things like these, because the energy hasn't started melting and its movement has not started. The snake thinks himself that he can destroy anyone, is capable of destroying any living creature. That is symbol of anger and ego. It's a false identification, and according to Sufis, we have given different classifications of nafs. So because of that, it feels very arrogant that it can do anything. Now you can identify this remains the state of man or a woman, whatsoever be the case. And it is capable of fighting with anyone because the energy is there. It has not been sublimated. So when Krishna enters into the fight and it has almost subdued the snake king, his wives, which are anger, jealousy, hatred, they come pleading. When anger is subdued, it becomes all these in composite form gives way for love. Jealousy is no more there, compassion is born, and the other side, the anger transforms into love, jealousy transforms into love, hatred transforms into love. For the first time you experience the pangs of love, but still it has traces of these negative aspects. So the energy has to transcend. It has to move from there. Krishna instructs at the pleading of the wives that you move elsewhere. But where will it go? What is the safest place where the snake feels safe? Because it was afraid of being killed by the king of the birds, who is against the snakes, and anytime it sees the snake, kills the snakes. So because of that fear, the snake along with his wives came and found a shelter in that river where the king of the birds cannot enter because of a particular curse. It has to move from that center. And what is the safest place? Krishna instructs it to go into the ocean on a particular island. In the ocean there is an island. You have to go to that. Now, is it symbolic or does this ocean and island stay somewhere? Now, one thing we have to understand very clearly, when I am speaking of these things, I am speaking in my oceanic form. Ocean is not Ganges or Nile or Hudson or Thames or any other. It is sum total of all the rivers where everything has merged into totality. That is the presence of ocean. This is a holy month of Ramzan and considered to be an auspicious month for Muslims. And according to Hindus, it is considered as most inauspicious month where no prayers, nothing is undertaken. If you have to start a new venture during this month, it cannot be done. So does it mean the month is different for Muslims and different for Hindus? Or the sun or the moon or the stars or God is different for Hindus and different for Muslims? It is the society that creates that. For Hindus, this month is very inauspicious, and Muslims it is auspicious. It does not appeal to me. So when I am speaking, whatever is necessary for the growth of human consciousness, in my oceanic form, I speak that. Human body is composed of 2/3 parts of the water. This symbolizes the ocean. In the center of that, there is an island which is known as the place where the heart intersects, where the horizontal and the vertical lines, the energy, there are two axes, X and Y, one moves horizontal, the other moves vertical, and where the two intersect one another, that is the place known as the island. Jesus calls it as Sacred Heart. Hindus call this as Hrida Chakra or Heart Center. Sufis have given it a name as Kalb. It is the island, and in that form all the negativities vanish. Anger, hatred, frustration, jealousy, fear is no more, and instead all this is transformed into love. So first of all, the energy has to melt, it has to move to the other center, and the two centers will merge into one another. The union at the physical plane attains a new dimension, and then it begins to move to the other center, which is the third center. It is in the center known as solar plexus. It is through this center you were once connected to your mother through the umbilical cord, and you were getting your nourishment from there. In the same way, existence is a womb, and you have severed your connections with that, with the universal womb. So once again, through meditation and movement of this energy, this connection is once again established. And once that connection is established, you are getting your nourishment beyond the food that you consume. It is the life force that keeps on coming into you, and in the form of Alan Vitae or life force of Pranavayu, because you are connected to the cosmic womb. And when energy moves there, from there it begins to overflow towards the heart center, and for the first time the heart center or Kalb, as Sufis call it, is in woot. It begins to woot. It was dormant, and the Zakir means something that was not awakened, something that was in a dormant state begins to activate, begins to function in its all natural way. At this level, the lower emotions are transformed into the higher emotions. Although the process has begun from the very beginning, the moment your energy begins to melt, a different kind of, what we say that there, a different kind of glow comes on the face of the male or the female, as the case may be. When the energy begins to function and one enters into male-female relation, a different kind of glow comes onto the face. But if there is a total fulfillment, then the glow is of a different nature, a different kind of satiation comes. This is why meditation is very important. It is the common factor that you are entering into this male-female conjugal relation. So then, when the second set of centers merge into one another, there emotional fulfillment comes in. People enter into the marital, the male-female conjugal relation, but the fulfillment does not come. Emotions are not satisfied, emotions are not fulfilled, and a kind of a frustration, kind of jealousy, kind of anger remains there. When sex remains unfulfilled, anger comes in. You become jealous of if the other begins to exhibit any kind of harmony or bliss or joy, you become jealous of it. So all these are the effects of unfulfilled sex. And when the sex is fulfilled, then everything is transformed into love. And sum total of this transformation into love, it activates the heart center, or Sufis say that Kalb is invoked now. The journey begins. Then the third aspect of the male conjugal relation begins, where the expression, before that you look at it in the expression, the language, the effect of the language of the person who is unfulfilled as far as sex is concerned is totally different than that of a person who is who has attained a fulfillment through this male-female relation. The expression becomes different. This is the throat center, center of expression. Below that is the realm of the world. Above that is beyond the body, beyond the mind, beyond the intellect. You are at the threshold. You can come back into the world, or you can transcend beyond the world and go into the higher realm of the new mind. Then comes the center at the eyebrow, which is known as the center of instructions. When these two centers merges into one another, the dualities comes to an end. This, according to yoga, is known as the center of Brahma, the center of creation. When the energy reaches to that point, one attains to creative dimensions. One becomes creative. This is why sometimes it becomes necessary if the master finds that the energy is not moving in the right direction, he lends his energy and tries to inculcate the aspect of creativity in the seeker, so that the energy that was going wayward begins to move into a creative aspect and the person attains the creativity. This is the story that Sufi story which I had narrated many times. A master was, his life was coming to an end. He has three disciples and he gave them 17 camels. He said, these camels I want you to divide among three of you. The first one gets the half of the camels. The second one, that is, the second one gets one third of the camel, and remaining two camels, the third one gets. Now, camel is a living object. It cannot be divided into parts. And it was very difficult. So this was a parable so that the seekers, the disciples, could find the right master who could interpret this parable. So they look around and nobody is able to solve the riddle. 17, how it could be divided that the first one gets half, the second gets one third, and the remainder two, the last one gets. Finally, he goes to a master. He said, this is not a problem. You have 17 camels and I have one. I lend you one of my camel, so the number becomes divisible. It becomes an even number. Even number can be divided into half, one third. So half of 18, 17 camels plus 1, 18, half of that is 9. So the first one gets half of the camels, which is 9. Otherwise, half of 17 is 88 and a half, and it cannot be done that way. So he lends his one camel, number becomes even, divisible both with the even number and odd number. First one gets half of the camel, 9. The second one gets one third of the camel, which is 6. So 9 plus 6 is 15. He says, I am taking back my camel. So the remainder 2 gets third person. So the division became very easy. So what does master do? When he finds his difficulty, he lends his energy so that your journey becomes possible. Because sometimes it is not possible to enter into a physical relation with the seekers. Physical relation, I mean the male-female relation or conjugal relation, then in order to help the seekers, he lends his energy in a different form so that the quality of the creativity is born into you and that energy erupts into creative form. The moment you are creative, it means your energy is fluid-like, it begins to move and it is being channeled into right directions. Love is born. It is not necessary that only through the male-female relation, the conjugal relation, that one attains to blissfulness. One can attain to this blissful state through other means also if there is no possibility of male-female relation. So those who are single, those who have no intentions of going into, they can use their energy in a creative form. Or if they ever had the experience of the male-female relation, go into that relation meditatively. There would have been, although you had no physical relation with anyone, or the marriage has been annulled, or divorce has arrived, is still, and even for those who are in the constant relation, go into those moments when first you start the journey from here. On just as on an anniversary, we do celebrations. The celebration of the anniversary should be the remembrance of the first day when both of you met and love took its first pangs and it began to blossom into you. That remembrance is very important. When you begin to recapitulate and remember it meditatively, the energy moves in a totally different way. You understand each other's emotion better. So this is the way you enter. And that there would have been moments when you had attained total fulfillment as involvement into the physical male-female sex relation. Recapitulating this, a different kind of a compassion or love is born into you, and then you can forgive your male or female, your spouse. The moment you attain to this state of forgiveness, that you are ready to forgive, although you are doing it meditatively, but its effects begin to spread into your life, and you can forgive anyone for these minor things. Otherwise, it was very difficult for you to forgive the people and you was continuing to be a nagging person. And everybody says that person is a nagging one, always quarrelsome, and so then a different kind of energy begins to flow into you. This is where the third aspect of the marital relation, the male-female relation or the movement of the energy, attains fulfillment. And so this sixth center is known as center of creation. And according to the Hindu way, Brahma is the center of creation. So it is known as the center of Brahma or the center of creation. And it is said, even in all the mythologies, God willed, let there be world, and world came into. So this is how does existence can come into, something can be created through the thought process. You can understand it now. When, first of all, a thought comes to the human mind, whatever field you are in, whether you are a writer, whether you are in the field of any other creativity or cook or anything, a thought comes, how, if I mix these two things, what will happen? You go into an experiment. An architect, first a thought comes to his mind to have a building in a particular design, particular structure. Nobody knows what is your thought. Until he puts it onto the paper, still those who are the people who can understand the one-dimensional draft, they can understand what the building will look like. Then finally he makes a model of it that will give a better understanding. So first a thought comes in, then a draft is prepared, then a physical model is prepared for the building or anything, and it is put on the display, then the actual production process begins. So this is what happens. First, through the thought process, the entire world, the entire existence comes into existence. The entire existence of that building, that particular dish, or that particular writing that you have, first a thought comes in, then you start creating the characters, you start speaking through the characters, and the whole novel, whole book comes into existence. It is through the thought process. So this sixth center is the center of creativity, or according to the mythology, it is known as Brahmalok, the center of Brahma. And the creativity is very important. So these are the recapitulation of that energy, how it's supposed to move. And when it begins to move, it journeys through all the centers. It is like a travel. You are journeying from your home and you are reaching to a destination. You are at your home, no excitement, nothing is there. You begin your journey. On the way there will be tiredness, as well as there will be places of entertainment and other things. You pause at this center, at this tourist destination, you visit that place, you enjoy, and then you move on to your journey. So on the way you are entering into many moments of joy, fulfillment at each stage. So when the energy moves from Mooladhar, or the base center, to the second water center, the first center is known as the earth center. So earth is fixed, immovable. Water has a flowing nature. So the from earth to water, from a fixed state to a movement state. This is why the person whose energy is stuck at the earth center is very rigid. You cannot make any dent into that person. No, I don't want that. That's it. There is no flexibility in that center. When it begins to move, the water begins to flow, flexibility comes. Now you can look into what kind of the way you had, a total rigidness. Whatever you say, that's how it has to be. No change. No, I said it so. You become supple, flexible. The energy moves to the third center. Then the solar plexus center is known as the center of fire. Now first the ice has to melt, then ice has to begin a water-like, then the water has to be put on the fire, and the fire is lit. With the heat of the fire, the water begins to boil. And when it reaches the boiling point, then the process of evaporation happens. So below these three centers, the solar plexus, the water center, and the earth center, according to Hindu mythology, they are known as this Patal Lok, nether world, which is not visible to you. But the world that begins above that is visible. The water begins to evaporate. Its direction is changed. That which was not moving begins to move. But water moves from higher altitude to the lower. It does not move otherwise, except there is a place in Mecca where when people go for pilgrimage, in that place the water moves in the otherly direction. Instead of moving from a higher altitude to the lower, it moves from the lower to the higher. Even the vehicles, when they are put in the neutral direction, they go move against the direction of the slope. It begins to move towards the height where the altitude is higher than the slope. And the water, when you throw the water, instead of going in the slope direction, it moves to the other direction. Nowhere else does that happen, and that is symbolic as well. So your energy begins to evaporate, and it attains the cosmic form. First it fills within you, and when it begins to overflow within you, it gives a satiation, a bliss and happiness, a fulfillment. When you are fulfilled within, then it will begin to overflow in the outer world. When it begins to give you fulfillment and satiation, then your expression changes. Your countenance, your face, expression on the face, the words that you speak, the language that you speak, that begins to change. And when it begins to change, your world, your words have a different kind of force. You speak to someone, it creates a lasting impression on the minds of the person. When you tell them something, because it is coming out of your total fulfillment, it has a different kind of influence, a creative influence onto the person that you speak. You become very forceful. And this is what happens when the master speaks. He speaks from a different kind of a level. The words, the flow, the energy is totally different. And through the words, he transfers his energy, transforms his bliss, he transfers his fulfillment and his totality onto the seekers. And in a miniature form, the same begins to happen through the seekers. So sometimes it happens the master, when he finds a certain seekers, they have attained a certain level of inner fulfillment, they start taking services of those people. These people who are now new entrant, they are asked to go to this person. So in the process of spiritual development, these people who are at a higher stage of development, higher state of inner development, they are helpful to the new entrants. This is why the Sheikh had asked Professor to do something, to write something, and I had asked him because his level is such that when he speaks to someone, the person becomes convinced because he is speaking from a different level. He is not speaking from the level of mind or level of intellect. His energy, when he is speaking, moves from the heart center, and that is why through him a lot of people will be directed towards the spiritual path. And that it's only up to him to recognize it, and the moment he recognizes it, it will become a great force in the spiritual field. Even for the masters, even for the sheikhs, whenever there is a state of confusion in a particular seeker, he can be directed to this particular person, go to him and he can clarify. In the beginning, when I was living with my uncle, the Sheikh Sufi Omkar Nath Raziyallahu Ta'ala Unhu, a talk has taken place, everyone is dispersed, the master is gone. Now the seekers who have come from different places and are staying in the master's place or the Khanka, they have certain queries because they did not understand the message what the master said. So they all refer these things to me because I was able to give them a clear vision of what the master has said and how it relates to their lives. So this has become my assistance. It was all planned by the Sheikh, and only thing is this, I recognized it and started functioning in that direction. A simple acts or simple happenings in their lives, they were not able to understand. Someone has a dream and he does not get an opportunity to speak to the Sheikh, or Sheikh is too busy, he speaks to that person and that person immediately gives a clear vision of what it is and brings a greater understanding in the seeker. So this is why the people who are at different levels of spiritual development, they have to step forward and come to assist in this process of this whole process of spiritual development or transformation of human consciousness. It is not only that a flower has attained, the bud has become a flower. When it becomes a flower, still its role is not finished. It leaves the seeds, the petals fall and they become the manure, and every aspect of the life becomes important in the process of blossoming or attaining fulfillment, or in the process attaining the fulfillment or transformation of human consciousness.